Welcome, friends, to this monthly meeting, which they call monthly community meeting. We are a good, nice community, nice family. Because of my age, when I come to these meetings, you all look like children to me. I feel it's a big family, all these are my children. I can't help this feeling. That is why I share things here which are not typically lectures on a spiritual subject, but share my feelings which I am sharing with a family. That's why sometimes I mention some of my own events of life. I remember last time I mentioned in the context of what happens when you make a deal with a perfect living master, that he takes over all your worries and you get all the happiness in return, which some friends of mine tell is a very unfair deal, very unfair to the master. But it's a working deal. For a master to take over all your worries is easy. For you to give up worries is very difficult. That's why deals fail. Otherwise, if you really stop worrying, master will take over all your worries. Now, the implication of that, people thought, was that they don't have to do anything in life. It's all changed. Karma is changed, all taken over by the master. And I mentioned last time, that is not true at all. Karma still plays out exactly as it was supposed to play. But instead of worrying about it, you just go through the karma cheerfully, wonderfully, enjoy it. Both ups and downs. The ups and downs still remain, but the worry is transferred and you feel happy that somebody else is taking care of you. So I experienced this in my life. I shared it, that this deal I made at a very early age with my perfect living master, great master, Hazur Maharaj Baba Sawan Singh, and it has worked throughout life. In November, I'll be 92. So I'm not just talking of a few years, I'm talking of a whole lifetime. A whole lifetime it worked that I did not have to worry about anything. And I was constantly aware that my master, who I can imagine and my imagination even see, is taking care of all my worries. This was the real meaning of the deal. But I got so many emails. We want the same deal because we have to work very hard now. A job is very hard. We want a deal so we don't have to work. That is not the deal at all. So I was clarifying this last time. In the clarification, I said, like anybody else, I worked very hard on my jobs. I got sick. I got surgeries done. I am a half artificial person now. Artificial knees made of titanium. Some part of my mouth now made of titanium. My ears, I don't have the artificial ears right now because I'm not going to listen to you. I'm just going to talk to you. Eyes, I'm wearing artificial eyes. That means I'm wearing contact lenses. So this is, all this happened like anybody else would go through. No change in the karmic pattern at all. I had an accident in Rome. My young son, 4-year-old son, died in the accident. Most people would be very concerned about that. I was not. My colleagues, I was able to explain to them what death means while the body is lying there. They said, aren't you? You must have gone crazy. That's why you are not mourning and grieving. I was also injured. I still have a mark of a broken arm. I broke my arm like anybody else would in an accident. No change in the karmic pattern. When I came back, it was in Rome, in Italy. When I came back to Delhi, my mother-in-law, also disciple of great master, came to me and said, how can you remain cheerful after your son's, after the death of your son, the only child at that time? How could you be cheerful? I said, I have a deal. I don't have to grieve or worry. Great master taking care of that. I said, your master is taking care of that. She says, but you know, my relatives are going to come to the hospital to see you. Will you be able to make a sad face for them? I said, that I can try. So I tried to make a sad face, but sometimes a little smile came up because I said, I'm acting very poorly. That is the meaning of that deal. Karma does not change. You still go through it, but you have the capacity to cope with it cheerfully, and you have the capacity to work it out much better than what the mind normally wants to deal with it. It's a transformation in ourself. It's not difficult for a master at all to take over. The difficulty is in our part to keep the deal. If you start worrying, somebody comes and says, can I have a deal? I say, yes, let's have a deal. He goes out, will the deal really work? And that's the end of the deal. He's worrying about that. He's worrying about whether the deal will work. Other worries will continue. I also mentioned that I am very bad financial manager. I have debts upon my head. And I happen to say that I am planning to sell my house. It's a very nice house. My wife doesn't want to leave it at all. She says, you have been on transferable jobs. You are moving from place to place. I used to decorate a house and then we would move. This house is my last house. So we have stayed here for a long time. She has remodeled the house, built many extra rooms, including a very private space for me. We call it the den. Beautiful house, but I'm going to sell it to pay off my debts. The moment I said that last time, within the next few days, I got a number of emails from my friends. You are settling all the doubt. Does that mean you are going to leave the body? Are you going to die? That's why you're settling these amounts. There was no connection between the two. I was just mentioning that like anybody else, I am living exactly a life like anybody else with my own karma. No change. So when they said, oh, because you are selling the house, okay, we'll help you. Without selling the house, we can help you. I said, what am I going to do? I'm not going to carry the house with me. In fact, I don't need 6 bedrooms. Nor does my wife need 6 bedrooms, but she can use 6 if she wants to. She can spread a lot of her things around, which she does. So a large house, actually, I was going to sell the house much earlier because the builder, it's a very good location. It's the highest per capita income in this location of Chicagoland. I was going to sell the house to a builder who offered me $1.2 million for the house, whereas the appraisal I had got earlier when I got a reverse mortgage on it was only $1 million. So I asked that builder, do you like my house so much that you are offering me $1.2 million, not $1 million, which is the appraisal, last appraisal? He said, no, I am going to destroy your house. I am not paying you for the house. I am paying you for the land. Because under current regulations, we cannot in that area have a land lot more than half an acre as the most for building a house of any size. You have grandfathered into 2 acres. So we can make up to 4 houses on your land. I said, so you plan to make 4 houses? No, I'll make 2 mansions. I'll break down your hand and land and your house, and I will build 2 big mansions, and I'll sell them for $2.5 million each. I'll spend only $3 million in making the best mansions, so I'll make $2 million profit. $1.2 million, nothing I'm giving you. I was very surprised. I said, he has no care for my house at all. Now, these are the kind of things that happen. So the house itself may not be worth that. The land was a thing for which he was paying. So my wife said, I will not leave this house till I die. We rejected the proposal. Now I told Jonathan, I said, Jonathan, I want to clear my debt. It's a good thing to be debt free. Not because I'm going to die or something. That is in the hands of my master. I want to clearly tell you the day I have to leave this body is clearly and completely in the hands of Great Master Baba Savan Singh. If I had to tell you what my normal age would have been, I can tell you. Very efficient astrologers have made a chart for me. One astrologer had made a chart when I was a child, and his charts were mostly correct for most people. He said, in my young age, I'll become blind. So I'll be a blind man, and at the age of 52 or something, in the 50s, I'll have an accident and die. Another man made a chart saying the blindness is still there, but if he survives, then there's a provision, if he survives 52, he'll go up to 84. My charts end there. I am 92 and not blind. How do you account for that? Though very good astrologers, the truth is, in college, I was blinded by an accident where concentrated nitric acid fell into my eyes. I was totally blind for 2 days. Third day, restoration of eyes started, and I can see today. Change. Now the karma was still paid, but lightened by Great Master's intervention. After that, I survived an accident where I could have been killed. I did not get killed, but I got injured. Karma was paid, but it was made little lighter to how I could cope up. Why was it made lighter? Why didn't I die? I asked Great Master, what happens when you intervene? He says, when you are doing some seva for me, I can give you extra time, and I've given to certain people, he told me. So I now know that this body of mine is sitting here in front of you on an extension of time, given to me from time to time till I can do seva for my master. I have no other purpose in life, no other ambition in life, except to carry out his orders, to do this seva. I'm mentioning these things because please understand that when a heavy item of karma comes, difficult for us, masters do intervene. They don't cancel it. They make it more bearable. They make it possible to cross it and move on. That's the truth. So, it's just a clarification I'm giving again. Don't think that because you have a deal, you can sit at home and money will flow from the trees. You have to work. You have to live your life in the ordinary way in the society in which you are living. No change. What is the requirement? If you want to have your life as a spiritual life, if you want to convert your regular life into spiritual life, remember, without waiting to meet the Master, transfer your worries to the Master. In meditation, he'll take over. Then you rest assured. Every day get an assurance if you are not sure that worries are in the hands of Master, not you. Your life becomes different. With the same karma, it becomes different. Secondly, do not create more attachments. We already have plenty. It's the attachments that have brought us back to this life again and again. All reincarnation is because of attachments. If you had no attachment, you wouldn't be here. Leftover attachments of one life lead to another life. And we keep on holding on to things here, knowing fully well, nobody has been ever able to take what we are holding on here at the time of death. Nobody has ever taken it. And yet we accumulate so much stuff. We have attachments with people, with children, parents, friends, and we think that is love. It's not love. It's just that you have an attachment. In attachment, there's a difference between attachment and love. I'll tell you this. In attachment, you think of both yourself and the one to you whom you're attached, the thing to which you're attached. I love my child. I am aware of myself and my child and what the relationship is, attachment. I love my car. I and my car both in my mind, attachment. I love my house. I and my house, both two connected. Always two in attachment. In love, only one, the beloved. When you fall in love, you forget yourself. Only the beloved stays in your mind. True love is where ego gets pushed back, the I-ness goes back, and the beloved's experience becomes so strong that at that time you forget who you are. You're all concerned with what you are holding on. Now, most of these attachments are with people. It's easier to get detached from property, more difficult to get detached from people. So that is why if you want to practice not having attachment and yet live in this world, the question comes up, you are a family man, you have children. How will you take care of your children if you are not attached to them? How will you take care of children if you don't love them? Well, there is a very good answer given by great master. He said, no matter at what position you are placed in life, consider your obligations as duties you have to perform. Duty is very different from doing something out of attachment. Perform your duties to your children. Who lays down the duties what you should be performing? The society, the environment in which you live. Because every place on the planet is different. People live differently. Whatever your understanding is, based upon the traditions, culture you are living in, and you understand this is my duty to do to my children, to my parents, to my friends, to my job. Do everything as a duty. Not say, because I love them, therefore I am doing it, that creates attachment. The very important thing, do everything as if you are doing your duty properly, to the best of your understanding. You don't create attachment, you don't create a new karma. Old ones, we have to pay. Old ones, how do we pay old ones? When things happen, good or bad, say, good clearance, I paid off. Just like if you owe a lot of bills, and every bill you pay, you feel happy, I'm paying off my old debts. Pay off all your old karmic debts by realizing that whatever is happening in your relationship with anybody, it's a clearing of old debts. We do not meet anybody, we do not have any event of life without karma. Karma is a very big subject to study. Huge subject. How karma is created, how karma is paid off, how it's recreated again. Every time something happens to us in relationship with somebody, and we react to it, we create a new karma. Can we really stop reacting? Yes, we can. If you have constantly this thing in your mind, I am settling my accounts, you do not react. And the karma ends there. The moment you react and have an action in your mind, I'll take it out on this person, I'll do this thing, I don't like that person because of this. The moment these thoughts come, you're generating a new series of karmas. So one can have a virtually karma-free life if you just remember these things. Transfer your worries to the master. Do everything as a duty and obligation which are cast upon you because of your old karma. And do not unnecessarily create new attachments by saying, I want this very much, I want this. Because desires are actually creating attachments. Buddha said that the only two things that are keeping here are desire and attachment. Which is true. When we are attached to something, we want more of it, the desire increases. If there is desire is for one thing and we are tired of it, we want a variety of that thing. Natural tendency of the mind. We have to keep a watch on the natural tendency of the mind and see that we change these things, you will have a spiritual life, a real true spiritual life. And a true spiritual life makes it so easy. You'll be surprised at how difficult we are making our life just by these things, by attachments and by worrying. Worry is one of these strange things that we worry about things which need no worry. I had a seminar once in Zurich, I remember, on worry. I said, tell me what are the points on which you normally worry? They listed. I said, no theoretical. In your actual life, what caused you the maximum worries when there were a lot of stress on you because of the worry? And they made a list. I said, how many of them actually happened? Not even 5%. Not, in many cases, none whatsoever. We worry about those things which never happen. Oh, this can happen. Tomorrow that can happen. This might happen. All those worries are useless. What will happen, will happen. Your worry never changes it. If we know this fact that worry doesn't change anything, why are we worrying? I went to a church in Rochester, and a sign at the church, St. John's, said, worry is praying, it's a prayer, worry is praying for failure. If you worry, you're praying that you will fail, whatever you're doing. That's an important lesson given by a religious institution. The worrying has never helped anybody. So we spend so much time worrying about things, and we worry what will happen tomorrow, what will happen later. A sense of insecurity comes in us. If we didn't worry, we wouldn't have that insecurity. The insecurity, what will happen? I have a few friends, millionaires, they are worrying the money will run out. What will happen when they are dying? I said, I know, I can tell you what will happen. You will leave all the money for your inheritors. Worrying is not going to change anything. They worry about things which are never going to happen. So that is why it's useless to waste time on worrying about things. What will happen. And no amount of worry is going to change it. There is a distinction between being concerned about something which you're tackling, and worrying. Concern is that you know what is to be done, and you take care of it. You know we have a problem, solve it. The problem should be solved. It does not mean worrying does not solve problems. Concern about how to solve problems, finding a solution, is a different thing altogether. Once a very nice old man with a white beard came and gave a talk in India. I liked him because his beard looked like Great Master's beard. So I invited him for tea at my house. He said, you liked my talk? I said, no, I like your beard. He didn't like that comment too much. But he talked about how to do things in life. He said, problems should never be shelved, never postponed. He said, when a problem comes before you, any problem in life, first greet it, then meet it, then beat it. Simple formula. First, greet, welcome problem. Not I'm only avoiding the problem. Welcome the problem and meet it and see what the problem is, and then beat it with your solution, best solution you can find. Make it a way of life that we have not to move around, because he explained later that when a problem comes, our first tendency is how to put it off. Procrastinate about handling anything. Okay, I can do it tomorrow, maybe later on I'll think about it. It should be handled right there and then, in the best way you can. Because if you were able to see karmic patterns from above where they were made, you will see the solution will be exactly what you do, no other. No matter how much you plan, even the solutions you find to your problems are also predetermined. It only the mind thinks like that. How are these karmic patterns made? How are we looking so different from each other? It's a very interesting point. that we are all human beings. We have lots of things in common in our bodies, in our minds, in our thinking, in our sense perceptions. A lot of common things, and yet we are all different. Our faces are different. I was surprised to hear the other day our ear, shape of the ear is different. Our thumb impressions are different. Our little pattern in the eye, on the iris, is different. Completely. The thumb impression, they say, the odds of finding two people with the simple lines on your fingers and on your thumbs look such a small place. The odds are 1 in 5 billion. The whole population, human population of this planet is 7 billion. Chances of meeting somebody with the same fingerprint is 1.5 to 1. That means out of billions of people, out of all the population, hardly one or maybe two persons may have the same fingerprint. When it comes to the eyes, the odds are 1 in 100 billion. The population doesn't even exist. Look at the distinction. How can we, in a simple body made similarly in the mother's womb, growing the same way, same reproductive process, be so different? We have twins. My wife's sister gave birth to two twin girls. They looked so similar. We had to put something on them to distinguish who is who. They said, look, they'll just grow the same. Today they've grown up completely different in appearance and far more in their attitude towards life. It's completely different. Their life is completely different. How can they be? They are not twins, but identical twins. Identical twins are coming from the same source. So when you see how is the distinction taking place, we have to go to a place where these destinies are manufactured. As it happens, that place is accessible to us. Where is that place? Inside our heads. Not outside. It's inside our heads, inside our consciousness. We don't look at it because we don't look inside at all. We only look outside. Outside are differences. We don't see where differences are coming from. If you were to just go inside, two steps inside. One, concentrate your attention so much inside that you forget you have a body. Then what will happen? You still imagine you are there. Have you noticed that you are always imagining you are there? You can imagine you are flying. You can imagine you have come here. That imagination of yourself never goes away. The imagined self of yours, a little more beautiful and handsome than the outside, because that's your imagination. The imagined self of yours still has eyes to see. Imagined self of yours still has ears to hear. Imagined self of yours is exactly like this body. But it's not real, it's imagination. Now, if you can just hold your attention within yourself to just be conscious of your imaginative body, it'll be a great experience, because you will suddenly find the imaginative body of ours has far better sense perceptions than the physical body has. You can anytime close your eyes and read a newspaper with very fine print. In imagination, it's very clear. And that's not, we call it imaginary because we think the only reality is our physical body and the physical world. If you can forget that for a moment and look only at your imaginative self, which indeed is the astral self. People think astral self is something else. No, it's just the use of your perceptions without body is the astral self. If you can get that, you have a great opportunity in that imaginative body, in the head of the imaginative body, to see what is inside there by putting attention in the head of the imaginative body. See, it's very simple. We made it difficult because all our attention is outside. If you can pull your attention to the imaginative inner self and put your attention in the head of that, you will see the great factory where destinies are being manufactured. And we are sharing one of those destinies. It's amazing how the whole thing, our whole life program, all events of life are being made up in our head in a small little place which we can discover ourselves. What will happen if you are able to reach there? That's called the causal plane. That body that we still have, more than imagination, it's a body that we experience without a body form, without sense perceptions, full perception without sense perceptions. That body form has all the knowledge of the creation of the universe. You'll be surprised that the whole universe we are experiencing here is coming from there. It doesn't look like it, that our own head is creating this universe. This universe is nothing but an experience of sense perceptions. The inner one is also nothing but our own imaginative sense perceptions. Third one is the creative power sitting inside us. Good to go and see it. If you go there, you find that destinies that we are living here are merely a play of recorded memories. That we can generate memories and put them into a capsule. People have experimented in the physical plane and they have put suggestive memories in the head of people hypnotically or by powerful suggestions, and those people have believed that is their actual life. So it's not a very big thing. So when you put a complete set of memories, I sometimes give an example like a DVD. A DVD is also a play. Let us say there's a DVD of a drama that takes place, and when we play it, it plays in 1 hour, 30 minutes, long play, 1.5 hour play. When DVD sitting here, is sitting in zero time or is sitting in 1 hour, 30 minutes? Zero time. The whole play is sitting in a DVD, the whole play is in the DVD in every second, every moment. It doesn't require it to be present and examined by us as a DVD for 1.5 hour. But only when we play it, it plays continuously, creates the time of 1.5 hour, events come and go. Our life is based exactly on that. The memories that are collected for the DVD, which lets the pattern of life, are all in zero time and zero space. Only when you play the DVD, we get into space and time, which we are experiencing right here. It's such a strange thing to know. Our mind can't even understand sometimes. How is it possible when our experience of reality is all here, that is being generated from inside ourselves? But if you go to that second step, you'll find out, yes. Then can we change that? If we can, that means sometimes we don't like our play here. We don't know how we chose this life, if we chose it. Somebody must have forced it on us. We would have chosen a much better life. We would have been much richer, much more happier, much better relationships, better found, better partners, better good business, lot of money. That's what we would have chosen. How come we chose where we are sitting in? The truth is we never chose this. We just decided to play a DVD. When you play a DVD, you don't choose your life. You choose a play. You never say if the DVD is high or low, it's your life. It's the life of a play that you are watching. This life is exactly like that. We did not come here to make it our life. We came here to play a life which we can observe and enjoy. How come we forgot this thing? Why should we forget it? We play DVD, we are separate from the DVD, we see a movie on a screen. How come over here we don't have that opportunity to see it separate? No, we have a full opportunity to see it separate, like a screen. We can see this life exactly like we are playing a movie on a screen, but not from the character of the screen, not from one character functioning on the screen, does not see the movie. The witness sees the movie. The spectator sees the movie. We are the spectators of the movie of life. And we are watching it, not here. We are watching it from there, because this is being played out. How do we feel that we are here and not there? Answer is simple. It is the nature of reality. We want to see something real, always. People say we want to go to a real home, Sachkhand. We want to go to a true home. We want to make everything real. We want real experiences. Now let me tell you, there is no real experience at all in the world. Nowhere, not even in Sachkhand. There is no real experience. The only reality, only double-lined reality, is the experiencer and not the experience. We create all experiences, including experience of true home, including this experience. And all the time we want to have real experience. Therefore, this great ploy has been used by us to create this play in which, instead of separating ourselves from the screen of a movie, instead of separating the witness from the play, we have decided to enter the play by simply picking up one character of the play and sitting as an observer from the physical head of that character. That's all we are doing. We are not the physical body, we are not the imaginative body, we are not the mind, we are not even the soul. We are totality, experiencing something through these forms. Each of them has been made real by great devices. We have had a wonderful method of making reality. Reality does not exist as we know it, in no form at all. People talk of reality all the time, we'll give you real reality. There's no real reality. It's all designed and made up. If there's any reality, it's the one who's creating the reality and experiencing it, the experiencer, the self that experiences. Only real, all others are made up. So how do we make up? Look at the method we have used for the physical reality. First of all, hide yourself behind somewhere where we can't know that we are watching. Nobody looks inside the head of a body. A very good hiding place. Tell me a better hiding place. We are hiding inside this body at a place, best hiding place. Most preserved and covered in the head, in the skull, behind the eyes. Great hiding place we found. So we only look at the play and not where we are hiding. Well, it makes the outside more real. Not only that, we lay down rules of the play which should generate its own reality. Cause and effect, big rule. Everything happens with a cause. Everything has an effect. Very good. So then our consciousness can now say, this happened because of that, this happened because of that, more real. We made it more real by creating this whole law of cause and effect, which we now call the law of karma. Then, to design the script of this movie, we use this law. Okay, it will always keep on working in time and space. No, but we don't have time and space. Let's create it. How do we create it? Just like playing out what we have prepared. We prepared a life, and now we play it out, and it requires time and space, and we make it. Mind is making time and space. Our own mind is creating time and space. You go beyond the mind, there is no time and space, and there is more existence, if I can call it existence. The greater strength of the self lies beyond the mind. And we have created a space and time spread out all over just for the sake of our life. Why am I mentioning all this to you? That if you knew the reality of our own way of creating the universe and how it's been done, your whole attitude will change at every level, including this one. All we need is an awareness of our own self, nothing else. An awareness of our own self gives you answers to every question you ever had. And that awareness is available to all of us. It's available, but we don't use it. It's available to us no matter where we are. Wherever this physical body moves, the awareness goes with it. That's the very nature of life. Life is nothing but awareness. If you lose awareness, there's no life. Some people say, when we go under anesthesia, we become unconscious. That means unaware. It's not true. Ask people who go through anesthesia. They'll tell you a lot of stories what happened during anesthesia. We lose awareness of this and generate the awareness of something else. Then we have a very good feature with us in our hands called forgetfulness. Beautiful feature. If we hold on to all the awareness, nothing will be real at all. We will not create reality if we can hold on to everything that's in our memory. Very little we catch in the memory. We totally forgotten what our event was, what our memory was, what we were before this universe was created. We have no idea. Religion says, spiritual books say, your soul is immortal. Just a thought. Have you ever thought if we are immortal, where were we all this while, before we came in the body? Immortality will include even trillions of years is not enough for immortality. Even infinity is not enough for immortality. And if our soul is immortal and we hear these lectures and sermons all the time, where is that immortality? Can we find our immortality? Yes. One simple way to find. Find out your own self. Is it immortal or not? And you'll find it is. Why is it immortal? Very simple answer. When there is no time and space, you are immortal. If you are there and no time, you are immortal. If you are there and there is no space, you are everywhere. Now, when they say God is everywhere, where does this statement come from? It comes from the fact that if you are in zero time, zero space, you are everywhere and you are nowhere at the same time, simultaneously. If you happen to be there, you can't be zero, not there. Therefore, you are there. That's what is creating immortality for us. Experience it. That is step three, not step two. You don't discover immortality in steps two. First, imaginative self is step one. Finding your own cause, how this whole thing is being generated and dramas are created for creating reality, step two. Step three is where you find immortality. You will know you are immortal just by, what do you do to get step three? Imagine you don't have the awareness of step one and step two. Just like step one of an astral experience, of an imaginative self experience, fully comes when we are unaware of the physical experience. Similarly, the experience of our own immortality comes when we are unaware of this physical experience and our imaginative experience and our causal experience, we discover who we really are. Self-realization, properly defined, is that state. If you can't find your immortal self, you haven't found yourself. No matter what form you are in, if you haven't found how you can be immortal, you've not found yourself. True enlightenment will be to discover who you really are. Because it's the self that generates experiences and generates words. It's worth seeing it. It's worth knowing who we really are. And even when you find your immortality, don't think that you will lose all that you have here. You still have a lot of company. Because we are all participating in a show of immortality. We are all immortal. See how many of us are here, how many are sitting outside. All immortal, including all the plants, including all the insects and animals, including every germ sitting inside you, every bacteria sitting inside you, all immortal. And we say they have such short lives. No, they're forms of such short life, not who they are. The self in each one of them is immortal. And only in one form of life can you discover that immortality. I'm sorry to say that. Out of what they count as 8.4 million forms of life, only one form has the ability, opportunity, and all the facilities required to discover that immortality happens to be the human form. What distinguishes the human form from all other forms of life is a strange experience. Very strange, but completely common and known to everyone, called the experience of free will. We decide what we want to do. We decide to pick this or pick that or not pick at all. This is amazing that we are the only ones. Everybody else lives in their pre-programmed life. Every other form of life is born, grows, dies. Never decides, should I do it or not do it? No other form of life. Neither plants, nor insects, nor birds, nor animals, nor angels, nor gods. Well, we can understand these plants and insects not thinking about things and just living their life according to the instincts built into their program. What about angels and gods? How come they lose their free will? They have consistent awareness of what is going to happen. They don't make decisions at all. They go with it also, like plants. Can you imagine we worship these gods and the gods have less power to make decisions than we have? At least so we feel. Now that's another issue. Do we really have free will? Or just an experience given to us to find our own truth? It's only an experience given to us so we can find our own reality and immortality. We don't have real free will. If it was real, we change the destiny right here. It is not in the form of the astral plane. It's not in the form of the causal plane that we can discover who we are. But in a lower form, so-called lower form of a human being. Somebody once asked me, tell me truthfully, which form of life is the best? I said, just short of the immortal form of a soul. I think the best is human form, physical form, not astral form, not the form where you can fly anywhere into any galaxies you like, not the form where you can do anything you like without creating karma, not even that. The life that is here gives us a chance to go beyond all these. And simple reason, because we have an experience which is not available anywhere else called free will. Free will is an experience created in us by completely blocking to us the knowledge of the future. That's all. If we had full knowledge of the future, free will be finished immediately. Free will makes us feel we can change the future. Now, when people look at destiny, they think destiny means what events will happen in the physical world. That is not destiny. That's only a very small part of it. Major part of destiny is how you will think, how you will rationalize, how you will use logic. That is predetermined. These physical events are much later. How you will think, reason, and take decisions, that is pre-programmed. That's the basic destiny. When we are here, the experience of free will only comes because of our reasoning in the head. Oh, I think, let me see what I should do. This is better, this is not better. Okay, I'll do this. Thinking mechanism, what makes us think, wow, I thought out a good solution. I had these options to make. I made this decision. I made it. I made my destiny. That's how we feel. That's called free will. Now, if we go and look at our karmic pattern, we'll find we thought exactly like that. When? In the beginning of, before we were born, the package that we got for our destiny contained the manner in which we will think, contained the manner in which it's all programmed. It's the manner of thinking and making decisions is programmed. Now, is it a guesswork I'm making? And maybe it is like that. Not at all. Any one of you can check it out by going and seeing the whole future. You see the exact way of thinking was the one that you destined for yourself. So that is why this experience of free will is only an experience. Not a reality. But a very good experience, because this experience leads to an experience of seeking yourself. If there was no free will, that decision would not be made. You just live with the physical world as its own reality. But something in us tells us, especially at certain moments of life. When I'm saying certain moments of life, I'm not including only one life. All lives, in a whole pattern of reincarnations, coming again and again, in a whole pattern of several lives, a moment comes in one life. This, I don't belong here. This doesn't appear to be my place. Pre-programmed, but it comes at the right time. Even this thought comes at the right time. I don't belong here. I want to find out what is real. I am a seeker. I want to seek. These thoughts cannot come without free will. That's where the experience of free will generates these thoughts, and we work as if we have a choice to make. Very big thing. So it's so programmed that when you want to have that experience, we have already embedded it in our destiny. And at that very moment, these thoughts come, we seek. Our experience here continuously is of a free will. What we think is our choice making. Now I'll give you an example I've given once earlier. I met a strange kind of a man in India many years ago. I had gone for an interview to join the Indian Navy. After the interview, I came back and there was a man with a turban standing outside. And he said, "Do you have a piece of paper?" I said, "Yes, I got a bundle of papers with me." He took a piece of paper and he looked at my eyes and began to write something on it with my pen. Writing, looking, then he folded the paper, double folded, triple folded, said, "Hold it in your palm." Then he said, "Do you have another paper?" I said, "Yes." He said, "Now with your hand folded, take the pen and write the answers to my questions." So I'm holding that little paper he wrote earlier in my hand, and he says, "Give me the name of a flower." I said, "I know this trick. The most popular flower is rose." He's expecting me to write rose. I'm going to call off his bluff for today. I'm not going to write rose in any case, and I'm going to write the name of a flower he may not have heard of. So there's a jasmine flower grown in the north, not in the location where I was. So the Indian name, Punjabi name for that is chameli, C-H-A-M-E-L-I. I wrote C-H-A-M-E-L-I. He said, "Now, write a number between 1 and 10. I said, "Another bluff. Everybody writes 5. That's the middle number. I'm going to confuse him. I wrote 3. He said, "Write your date of birth." I wrote 1926. He said, "That's not your date. That's the year. Write your date." So since I had already written the year, I wrote after that November 26th. He said, "Open that little paper I gave you earlier." And on this paper I put aside, opened the paper. It said chameli. It said 3. And it wrote my year of birth first and then the name. Identical. I said, "This is not possible." Because when he wrote, I had not even thought of these things. I had not even decided how to answer. How could he write that which I had not even determined in my head? I said, "I am totally nonplussed by the way you have done. How do you do it?" He said, shall I first tell you something more? I said, go ahead. He said, when I asked you right name of a flower, you said in your head, he is thinking I am going to write rose. He knew even that. Therefore, you wrote chameli. When I asked you to write a number between 1 and 10, your thought was, he is expecting me to write 5. Therefore, I will write 3. He repeated all my thinking. I never spoke a word. That was the greatest proof I ever had that not only everything is predetermined, but your thoughts are predetermined. The manner in which you select things, the manner you make a choice is also predetermined. He could guess in advance how I will answer his questions, including the reasoning behind it. He spoke up all that. So I asked him then, please tell me how you do it. He says, we have a certain guru and we are called Bhatras. We are a small group of people. We call Bhatras. Very few are left now. And we practice a meditation by which we learn how to see a person who's in front the next 5 minutes of his life. And we just write it down. We protect. If you can know the next 5 minutes of a person's thinking, can you imagine how much the independence is of our thinking? Another person who I never met before should be able to write all that. The truth is, we don't have to go to that man, a Bhatra, to find out. Go within yourself and see everything that's going to happen in your life written prehand. The way you will decide things, the way you are doing, there's no other way, second way. We all decide in the same pre-programmed way in our head. Our thinking is pre-programmed. That's destiny. So destiny, when we talk of destiny, we sometimes think it's only a matter of who we will meet, who will marry, where we'll be born, where we will die. These are minor events. The real destiny that's created, the DVD that's created, is how we will make choices, how we'll think, how we'll rationalize our choices. Interesting to see this. And this is all happening at the causal plane, which is accessible to all of us. Requirement: become temporarily unaware that you have this physical body by withdrawing your attention closer to yourself in the head. Become unaware of your sense perceptions by becoming still closer to yourself, and you will discover the truth of whatever stated today. Test it out. This is not something that I am presenting a theoretical model of the world. I am presenting a possibility that exists for all of us. If we are true seekers of the self, if we are true seekers of the nature of creation, if we are true seekers of the Creator, who is God, who is the real Creator, go within yourself and you'll find it. I'll take a break. You also enjoy a little break. There's some snack somewhere. I can't see it though. So I'll come and see you back at 3:30 again. So enjoy your snack and your break. I'll come and join you.